CO2 is created by every living thing on the planet, but also by burning fossil fuels, which is causing global warming, so what if we just trapped it all under the ocean? That would work, right? Howdy, oxygenators. Trace here for DNews. Every breath you take, you'll be exhaling CO2. In fact, each exhale contains 100 times more CO2 than was inhaled, totaling about 2 pounds of CO2 per day per person. Carbon dioxide is odorless, colorless, highly toxic, and apparently tastes pungent and acidic. Because Earth is a relatively closed system, carbon never leaves. It gets burned and then trapped and then breathed and then reused all over the planet all over again and again and again. Most of us probably connect CO2 with breathing. While we only release pounds per day, industry releases tons. And if we don't capture it, the CO2 will continue to exacerbate the greenhouse effect. In 2014, we were projected to release 37 gigatons of carbon dioxide into the air, which is more than the planet can absorb. This is getting serious. So scientists are working on ways to filter and trap this ubiquitous gas. In the 1930s, researchers figured out if you bubble air through a solution of a derivative of ammonia called an amine, the CO2 will be plucked out, scrubbing the air clean. We've since developed a bunch of other ways to capture it, but in 2014, MIT developed a super efficient process using electrochemistry, electricity plus chemistry. It's awesome. The researchers used these amines to pick up the CO2, just like in the 1930s, but they added a modern twist. When you bubble polluted air through an amine solution, these guys naturally want to cling to the CO2. They love it. But then electricity throws copper ions into the mix, and if you're an amine, copper ions are way more enticing than CO2, so they drop the toxic gas like a bad habit and pick up the copper. At that point, the lonely CO2 floats out of the system. Yay! Afterward, the copper is pulled away from the amines, who have to run through that process again and again and again. I sort of feel bad for the little hardworking guys, you know? But back to the CO2. So now that we've filtered it, then what? Well, because industry faces such strict penalties for releasing CO2 into the atmosphere, they've created carbon capture and storage technologies. Essentially, most companies take that filtered CO2, cool it until the gas becomes a liquid, and then transport it somewhere where they can store it. There are two major ways to do this. One is pretty straightforward, and the other one just seems crazy. The straightforward one is called geologic carbon sequestration. In the States, the U.S. Geological Survey has identified 36 different regions around the country where the CO2 could be injected into porous areas of rock between 3 and 15,000 feet underground, and hopefully, there it will stay. The second is the crazy one. It's similar, but it's oceanic carbon sequestration. In liquid form, CO2 is actually denser than water. So theoretically, if we just pumped it under the ocean, the water above it would hold it down like a big weighted blanket. A 2013 study in Geophysical Research Letters looked at the viability of pumping liquid CO2 to the bottom of the ocean and determined it would form a lake of liquid carbon dioxide. Yeah, a lake. The high-pressure, cold world of the deep sea would then hold it in stasis for maybe 1,000 years. I know what you're thinking. And yes, both of these ideas have their dangers. For example, in geologic sequestration, the pressure of the rock above should keep the CO2 liquid, and it should stay there. Should. But if the CO2 does find its way out of the rock, global disaster. In the undersea example, the implications are also dangerous. CO2 is toxic, remember, so it could drastically increase ocean acidity and deep sea life might not survive. Plus, if it did leak out, global catastrophe again. Look, there's no real permanent solution to CO2 problems except, you know, maybe venting it into space somehow or simply stopping the release of so much carbon. Pollution doesn't just hurt the planet, though. It can also hurt you. Check out this video to find out how.
Smog is caused by little particles that float around in the air. Lots of particles wind up in the air for all sorts of reasons, from house dust to dust from roads and sidewalks to exhaust from cars and power plants. It affects the body because many of the particles are tiny and can accumulate in your lungs.
And if you're down to listen to my weird voice some more, make sure you subscribe to my podcast. On each episode, we take about 45 minutes to dig into a topic just like here on DNews, but all the way through it, all the way to the brass tacks. Here's a taste. By analyzing boron, embedded in limestone from the Permian and Triassic periods, researchers found an abrupt shift in ocean pH levels. Now, pH is a measure of acid versus base, and life can only exist with a nice balance. Every time we talk about this stuff, I just kind of like never want to use fossil fuels again. What do you think? Do you ever feel guilty about your carbon footprint? Tell me about it down in the comments. Please subscribe so you get more DNews from us every single day, and thanks for watching.